My name is Srinath. So I work for a company called WSO2, so which is a middleware company. So I'll chat about that at the end. So thanks very much for being here. Okay, so let's start. Okay, so when I was a grad student, I used to work with this set of meteorologists. So they used to do these models and predictions and analytics for a long time, right? Like they use this technology, some of you know, called MPI, which was created like 1991, long time ago, right? And they were very good. I mean, this how we know when a hurricane comes, etc. So they have this joke that they say that there's an algorithm that could predict tomorrow's weather perfectly. But there's one catch. It just takes more than 24 hours to run, right? So not very helpful. So, okay, so now, this analytics and big data, people were doing for a long time. But to do that, you need these systems, these interfaces were very, very complicated, and you need supercomputers. That changed around 2004, when Google came up with MapReduce. And then we all know what happened, and we are here because of that. Now, one catch of these technologies, mainly MapReduce and MapReduce-inspired technologies, is that they take time to run. Okay. Now, let's say if you have time tracker or other exercise tracker thing. Okay, maybe you don't like. Let's say that company who collects that data, do analysis, and they can guess that you are going to have a heart attack in next 10 minutes. You don't want them to send you an email next day, right? You might be dead. So there's a lot of use cases like that, where the value of the insight and the output diminishes very fast as the time goes on, right? So those we call real-time analytics. So those needs real-time analytics. So the stock markets are where, in stock markets, these are measured in microseconds and milliseconds, right? Because there's a lot of money, lot of difference being made. So there was this story that they from New York to Chicago, which are the main two stock markets in US, they end up creating a straight line and communication line because if you go around, the latency introduced by speed of light apparently matters. Microseconds matters, right? So now when people talk about real-time analytics are the technologies that would generate results faster. There are two flavors. One is you know which query you want to evaluate. Okay, you let it run, query doesn't change. When something matches that, it'll let you know. Okay, so that version we'll talk a lot today. The second version, there's somebody who is working. He issue queries interactively. He come up with queries. He ask questions. He get responses. This is the second form. So people use this both the terms interchangeably. Okay, so now, the real-time analytics technologies, they are not new either, right? So they start from about 2000 plus, right? So they start from active databases, then, so each of these technologies, we'll talk about them in a minute. So this slide shows some of these technologies in context. Right here, the x-axis shows how fast you would get a response. The y-axis shows how much you could scale. right? Now, if you look at that, on the left-hand side, your right-hand side, you have MapReduce, which takes minutes to generate a result, right? But scales very well. Then you have, on the left corner, you have this complex event processing, stream processing, things like Apache Storm, et cetera, which could generate results pretty fast. They could scale, but it takes some work. We'll discuss those in a minute. Then you have this in-memory technologies, right? Now, generally you don't bring in these technologies unless your use case is big, because they're expensive. Otherwise, you just do it in your machine. Then in between, you have databases. So let's try to go through different real-time analytics tools, okay? So the first one, this is the most famous one. For example, one example is Apache Storm. We call it stream processing. This is basically a graph of processors connected. You put the events on one end, they go through the graph, and they produce results, okay? The second class is called complex event processing. So the difference, one more thing. Here, in this, each node you would have to implement. Generally, it would in all write in some code. In Storm case, you have to write some Java code. And then you connect them into a graph, and you process it. In this world, the second world, in complex event processing, they give you a lot of inbuilt operations. For example, they have time windows, patterns, etc. We'll discuss them in a lot of detail in a few minutes. So they have generally higher level query languages, often following SQL. Again, we'll talk about those. So you give one of these queries, and they would match the events against those queries, and it'll generate the results. So no code in general. Then the third class, we call it microbatch. This is, for example, Spark streaming. The idea is that if you make your batches smaller, so you're getting data. Now you might run a batch process, you might run MapReduce, but you make your batches smaller. Then it'll respond faster. Then you take those results and put it together, right? So it could, this cannot give you like microseconds or like close to milliseconds. It'll at least take few milliseconds. But for such use cases, it works okay. One catch with this is that simple aggregates, etc., counting you can do with this, but complicated scenarios, little harder. So we'll come back. The last class of systems, these are interactive systems. These are systems like Apache Drill, VaultDB, Druid, the SAP HANA, MemSQL, systems like that. They were built to support interactive processing very fast. Generally, they load a lot of data. Either they build indexes or build them to memory and do indexes. When you issue queries, it'll respond very fast. So the fourth one is used for that. I talk about two classes of real-time analytics. So this is the second class. The other ones belong to first class. Okay, now let us look at some of the real-time analytics problems or tools. Still, we are at the early stages of real-time analytics, so people generally just talk about counting, right? And there's a lot more. So if you look at the complex event processing technology, that's the second class, if you look at that technology, they have been dealing with a lot of complicated real-time analytics patterns. they were generally stock markets, mostly stock markets, those very niche areas, but those start to come up. The first case is simple counting, okay? The next, you count with a window. You might count number failures happen, then you count on a window. It's a sliding window, batch window, trembly windows, etc. Then you could do like data cleanup, filtering, transformations, okay? Next, this is the very famous use case, alerts. Temperature greater than this value, give me alert. This guy, I'm suspicious of this guy, give me alert. Now we start going to more little bit complicated ones. Data correlation, detecting missing events, etc. So a couple of weeks back, we were working with the customer. So they have a lot of sensors, but some of the sensors are faulty, and they have redundant data. So basically, we were correlating different sensor events and figuring out where that this sensor is bad, so throw it away kind of analysis. Then you join event streams. So let me give an example. So I'll later show a demo on a football game. So let's say you want to detect when somebody kicked the ball. So let's say you have a football game with a lot of sensors on the players and the ball, etc. You want to detect when somebody hit the ball. How do you do it? So what you do is you take the player stream and you take the ball's position stream and join them. Right? Join them and check, are they close enough and does the ball's acceleration change? Okay? So then you guess maybe they have hit. Then you might update databases. There's this something called event sequences. For example, you want to detect when a small transaction is followed by a large transaction. These are sequence of events happen over time, right? We'll come back again. You might want to track something, right? You might want to track a vehicle, track wildlife, etc. Track it over time. You might want to detect a trend, whether the temperature is rising, stocks rising, falling, and there are complicated patterns like triple bottoms, etc. You might want to learn a model, okay, and etc. Now what happened is most people think about real-time analytics with the sense of simple counting kind of scenarios. So, but there's a lot of details. So let's try to dig in. Can you, by show of hands, who has heard about Apache Hive? Okay, a lot of people, right? So the Apache Hive is a language, SQL-like, mostly SQL-like language, built on top of Hadoop. So you write what you want to be done in SQL query, almost SQL query. Then how you compile it to a MapReduce job, and it runs on Hadoop. Now, advantage is that a lot of people understand SQL, so it's easy to learn Hive. It's easy to write a complicated query, right? It is expressive, short, and sweet. And it gives you extension points. So if you want to do very specific, you could extend and do it. And therefore, it'll let experts to do their own thing if they want. And there are cooperations, like the SQL has joins, filters, etc., which cover about 90% of the use cases. So, okay, now let me ask you a question. So, you know, I'm sure you have done this at school, that they gave you a series of things. If A and B is together, and then they say C, and what goes in D. So if you take, it's Hive for batch processing, what is parallel for real-time analytics? Okay, so the one answer is Spark. So we'll chat. I have a little different answer. I'll tell you why, and we can discuss. So we'll discuss what CEP means in a lot greater detail. But the CEP, or complex event processing, actually plays the same role as Hive for Hadoop, because they follow very much SQL-like query languages, right? Expressive, short, and sweet. They define set of cooperations that covers a lot of use cases, and it'll let the experts dig in when they like. So let's look at some of these cooperations, and let's figure out why it is the case. So the first cooperation is filters. So it looks like this, right? So the first line shows a stream. The second line shows from this stream name, that within square brackets you have the condition, just filter, right? This basically is SQL. So with this, you could do things like alerts, pre-processing, filtering, etc. Okay, nothing complicated here yet. The second cooperation, windows. So you say, take this stream, take a window of 1 minute. So there are a lot of type of windows, but think a slide-in window for now. Window of 1 minute, then you could do aggregate functions. This is how you do moving averages, right? So with this, you could do counting with windows, etc. Okay, still, this very simple. The third co-operator, okay, this is a little complicated. This is a pattern. So let's say that you want to detect over time if the temperature had changed more than 5 Celsius within a day. So basically, you want to look through the temperature values over time. If it changed more than 5 Celsius in a day, you want to be known. So basically here, it says from first event, then you put the arrow, the second condition. Then on the second condition, you can tell what happened on the first condition. Okay, so this is very simple query. Actually, here you could write a regular expression. You could say this event, this condition, followed by n of these conditions, n of these conditions, etc. Okay, so this you use for detect event sequences, tracking trends, etc. Okay, the last case is a join. This the that kicking the football thing I explained. Here you say from this stream take a window, another stream you might take another window, then you join it on this condition. Okay, so you use this for data correlation, finding missing events, joining data streams, etc. Sorry. No, they can be on different sizes. So actually, could you hold? Let's get to the questions. Let me run through, because otherwise time will get, okay, thank you. Okay, so and the last operator is that you want to access data in a disk, database, right? So here, this let you map your data in a disk into an in-memory window, and then you could join with it, okay? So let me continue. I'll share the slides. You could have a look at it later in detail. So if we go back to that first list of patterns we discussed, the ones we have striked out are ones that are covered by cooperations, right? So they are actually, I mean, we have a complex event processing system. We were building it for like 5 years now. So these operations were pretty much enough for use cases we found so far, except for learning. predictive modeling, because so far the predictive models, the main approach that works has been doing batch processing. You build a model, you might update. So there are technologies like there's a project called SOMA, and there are a few technologies that can do streaming learning, but still it's on very research area. So for predictive analytics, the model we go with is basically build the model outside, then bring it to the real analytics flow. For example, if you want to detect credit card fraud, you might build the fraud model offline using batch analytics, then bring the model and evaluate against the model on the runtime flow, right? Because it's most of the time it's very expensive to build streaming models. Okay, so let me give you two use cases that shows some of these. Show some of these ideas in play, right? The first one, this is a football game. The game was played with sensors in players' boots, in the ball, right, and in the goalie's hands, gloves. And each event tell the location X, Y, Z, the acceleration, timestamp, the velocity, and acceleration, right? Then those events were collected. And then basically we do it by replaying, but potentially you could do it while on the live. So that your right hand side, you see the video sync with the 2D view. And in the bottom, you have a lot of analytics calculated with complex event processing, right? So let me tell about one analytic, right? So in football, if you want to measure how effective a player is, don't count how many goals he has scored. That's not fair, right? Okay, goalie gets 0-1. Defenders don't get to hit goals. So instead, they measure something called ball possession, right? So this is a measure. This basically how long you control the ball, right? Now, if you want to measure this, basically, you want to know when I hit the ball and until somebody else hit the ball and take the control from me. Within, between, I control the ball, right? Now, if you look at the third column, you can see that the different player, it shows the ball position. When the player changes, it will tell this guy is having the ball now. Now, way we did this was, first we detect hits. I already explained how we detect hits, right? You basically take the stream of the ball, you take the stream of the players, and you join them and see whether are they close by 1 meter, and ball acceleration go more than given amount. Then, now we have series of events detecting there was a hit at this time, there was a hit at this time. Now, to detect how long I possess the ball, it is a pattern. It says, tell me, detect this pattern where any hit by me, followed by any number of hits by me, followed by hit by somebody else. Then if you take the first event and the last event, you know how long you possess the ball. Now, so we did other things, like, for example, we did something to detect offsides, etc. But the important take-home message from this demo is that with these cooperations and SQL-like queries, how expressive you are, right? You could explain very sophisticated and complicated conditions, like in very concise and powerful way. So let me switch to the next one. Okay, so this one, so the London, actually London has set of data feeds given their public traffic data, right? So what we did was, is it playing? Okay, sorry. What we did was, we took those events and we send it to complex CP. And basically we did series of scenarios, basically detecting different conditions. Okay, so the first condition was that we use a data feed about buses. Okay, so this is done with, we have something called a toolbox, which is a pre-built set of scenarios, and you could send the events, any geocoded events. So you could see all these places are buses. If you click on one, it'll tell where it is, current speed, etc. Right? Then you could go to a specific place. Okay, so it shows the speed, etc. So then you could go and add speed alerts to specific bus. So let me wait. So you could put a speed alert on a specific bus. So then the UI would generate a query and deploy it in complex event processing. Then whenever these speeds are broken, you would get an event. It's a simple, the real-time analytics wise, it's a very simple query, right? Okay. Okay, so let me stop this. Let me go back to the slides. So these videos we'll put into YouTube, right? They are already on YouTube, actually. When I share the slides, you could get them. Also, if you come over to our, if you come into or to our booth, we can show it to you also. Okay. So again, I hope I stress this point, which is that the with these SQL-like queries, the complex event processing technology could explain very complicated scenarios in very concise way. Now, there is a catch. Actually, there's a reason people hadn't been using CP that much, which is that when you do some of these operators, these, like for example, windows and sequence of events, these are very hard to do in parallel, right? So historically, most complex event processing systems has been historically, there has been few node systems or single node system. Okay, so this is something we were trying to solve. So the next part of the talk, I hope I have made the case for real-time analytics with this CP kind of queries, is how we can scale this. So the first idea is that, now we know stream processing scales. Things like Strom scales. What they do is they create a network of processors. You have to code the processors. Okay, that's the hard part. You have to write code, you have to code the processor. Now if you try to, when you do counting, this is not a huge problem. Right, counting not hard to code. But if you are trying to implement a window, let's say a slide-in window, this pattern, etc., sequence of patterns, it's very hard to code. I have worked with like several CP engines. I have personally involved with implementing one in a lot of detail. It is not easy. The algorithms involved are very complicated. So on one hand, the stream processing systems like Strom give you this network of continuous processes. But the problem is you have to go and code each of these nodes. Okay? So what if we take a lot of CP engines and connect them into a graph? So, and then you send events through the graph, each CP engine process things, so you could scale. So we have the problem of data partitioning. I'll come back to that in a minute. So if data can be partitioned, you could build a network of CP engines, you could connect them, and potentially that CP engines could run on top of something like Strom, right? So each CP engine can be a stream vault. Okay, so that's the first idea. That's okay. Actually, I mean, this one is not new. People have done this. People have discussed this many times. People have production systems running like this. Now, but the catch is, it is painful to set this up. And there's a lot of work to do to exactly set it up. So the second idea is, what if user give me a SQL, like query or CP query, which look like SQL, and we build a compiler that will automatically build a network of Strom, network of CP nodes running on top of Strom. Okay, that will make the life much easier. But if you have worked with Hadoop, MapReduce, etc., you would ask the question, great, how do you partition the data? Because unless you could partition the data, putting it in a graph or network do not make it faster, right? Because you will have a one thread of execution. For this, what we said was, let's follow MapReduce. If you think about MapReduce, actually MapReduce do not know how to partition the data. By forcing you to define a map and reduce function, it forces you to figure out why are the data partitions. It just, you might not realize it because it's done in indirect way, but that's what actually happens. By selecting the keys emitted by the map function, you select how you partition the data. So we decided, let's do the same. Let's let the user specifically tell us how to partition the data in these SQL-like queries. So what we did was, we let them define partitions. For example, it says, define a partition on that temperature stream on the attribute region. Then run these queries within that partition. So what it does is, it creates its own partition for each of the value on the temperature streams region and run independent queries. So those queries could run in parallel in many nodes. And when that execution is done, when the partition is done, those events get collected into another stream and get processed. So these two queries is, in a way, stream in MapReduce written like a SQL-like query. Okay? So putting everything together, let me come back to that in a minute. So putting everything together, we tell users to write your queries. We ask them to figure out how to partition the data, their problem. Now, remember, in MapReduce, if you can't partition the data, if can't partition the data, MapReduce cannot run it faster, right? If you want an example, try implementing Fibonacci series calculation, value of 1 million Fibonacci using MapReduce. You can't do it in parallel because that, go and try, okay? So even in MapReduce case, not everything can be partitioned. Therefore, not everything, you can implement it, but it will run on single node for a long time. The same here. With this model, if data cannot be partitioned, it will be as if you run a single node. But if you can partition, the humans are, at least in current stage, in best place to figure out how to partition it. So users figure out how to partition it. They write the query. Then the query compiler compiles it into a set of CP nodes placed on top of Apache Strong. And it'll execute in parallel. So let me come back to this. So when you actually run this in parallel, when you run a streaming query in parallel, they would generate results independently, and the result might be in out of order. Now, when you code for Strom, you have to handle this yourself. Some use cases, order is not a problem. But if order is a problem, you have to handle it. Right? So again, the difference is between the Strom give you a very low-level API to directly code. So these details are on your hands. So this is a hard problem. So to solve this, if you want the order, basically you need to collect these events and reorder it. Now, when you try to do this, you have a problem because you don't know when I can send an event, because there might be an event before that still coming. So how you do this is you also add heartbeat events into the streams. So when the heartbeat event from all the streams has arrived, you could flush the events in order. Okay? So all these are implemented, so all these come up with on the next release of WSO2 Computer Event Processor. So we have a platform which does all this. So I won't talk about this in too much detail. So please come and talk to us at the booth if you want to know more about the platform. So let me summarize. So first, so we talk about real-time analytics, we talk about the scenarios, and we said that the CEP can play the role of Hive, similar to the role of Hive for MapReduce, right? Which is pretty easy to understand because it falls from SQL. It's expressive, very powerful, short, and very fast, right? It defines set of cooperations that will cover most of the problems, and it let you dig if you like. And finally, we had figured out a way to scale this, and it'll be available from next release of our product. So thanks very much. Please visit us on our booth, and I can take any questions. Could you come? So, because otherwise I had to repeat the question. Could you come to the mic? Okay. It is open source under Apache license. So the Spark streaming actually does not have advanced operations like this sequence patterns. So it has Windows. Last time I looked, it only had Windows, sliding Windows, right? So the complicated patterns are harder to implement with micro-batch systems. So if your use case matches there, that's okay. But these are much more expressive, much more powerful. Okay. Answer is yes. Actually, the Spark streaming is a little different because due to its micro-batch nature. Maybe we can chat a little bit after the talk. So it's a little bit different. We actually had a look at it because we already use Spark for our batch processing. So if you could do on top of it, it's much nicer. But it was tricky due to that, like, for example, doing that sequence pattern on top of it, etc., was tricky. But like other systems like Strom, this could work on top of that. For short term, we want to get the Strom version solid and working, but we would want to do the others as well. So still, it's not clear who would be the system on the stream processing layer. So basically, whoever the winning, we want to go with that. So, yeah. Sorry, you had another question. Okay. Yeah. So, for example, take that use case where so you are trying to detect a kick on the football, right? Now the event generated from the football and the event generated from the player's boot won't be exactly in sync, right? They would be a little bit off. Could you repeat the question? I might have. That is true, but the events are not collected at every minute. They are, for example, in this use case, they were collected at 60 hertz, right? So you might not get the timestamp on the ball and timestamp on the player may not be the same one. So they might be bit off. So that's, for example, therefore, what you do is you take like last second from the ball stream, last second from the player stream and join that. Figure out the offset. So that's one use case. So that's actually a lot like that. Anything else? Okay, thanks very much.